announcements. Men's Council will not meet on Saturday, November 7th. We will resume midday prayer this Tuesday, October 27th at noon using Zoom. Save the date, November 8th, 2020, the 151st anniversary homecoming service with the theme titled as The Times They Are A-Changing. David Street will have his congregation meeting today at 1 p.m. Reverend Bruce Grady will moderate the session meeting on Tuesday, October 27th at 7 p.m. The Zoom link will be emailed out shortly. The Catholic Charity Support Program is sponsoring its Wrap with Love Christmas store. Last year, they collected $1,600. With that money, they donated $500 to the Encouraging Place and also used $1,100 to purchase gift cards for families impacted by COVID. If you are interested in contributing, please see the information in the bulletin. If you are experiencing a pastoral emergency, please contact either Ms. Leah Harris or the church at the church or Elder Felicia Hardy. Sunday school will continue by conference call this Sunday at 10 a.m. You are invited to join us for intercessory prayer conference call on Thursday evenings at 7:15 p.m. For more information, please contact Bill or Maggie Thomas. Are you putting aside your pennies each mealtime? Please do what you can to support the Presbyterian Hunger Program. The fourth quarter sensibility offering total was $80.43. Thank you for your giving. This ends the announcements for the day. Let us worship God. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or before you formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. We come today to worship and celebrate you. You turn us back to dust and say, "Turn back, you mortals." For 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it is past, or like a watch in the night. You sweep the years away, they are like a dream, like grass that is renewed in the morning. In the morning it flourishes and is renewed. In the evening it fades and withers. Your steadfast love endures forever, so we come to worship and celebrate you. Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, so that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. We come today to worship and celebrate you. Amen. The prayer of the day. Lord, you are the one we turn to time and time again, no matter what goes on in our lives. You are our sanctuary when times are rough. You are our encourager when we feel disencouraged. You are our God who loves us even though we feel unloved. You are our host who welcomes us when we feel tired and weary. You are our nurturer when we need to be taught how to live as your children. And we are your children who seek to know you more deeply in our lives. We are your followers who seek to live as you would want us to live. We are your servants in a world that has so many great needs. We are who others look at as to see how one lives when they say they believe. And when we come back home to daily seeking that warmth, that love, that encouragement, your hospitality and love makes it possible to then live as your children so that all may find their home in you and feast at your heavenly table of plenty. Amen. It is our confession where we ask for God's forgiveness. So let us make our confession by reading the prayer of confession. Lord, we come to you with our unanswered question, selfishly seeking your affirmation of our behavior and opinions. We assume our own righteousness and quickly condemn others in your name. We forget that our ways are not your ways. Our judgment is not your judgment. We do not take the time to examine our hearts and seek your will. We jump to conclusions and neglect a life of prayerful disconcernment. Help us, gracious God, to humble ourselves before you and listen. Give us the courage to hear your corrective words and act upon it in ways that reveal our love for you through our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Gracious God, we know that you are with us always and that you offer us the peace that passes all understanding. May we share that peace with one another. May the peace of the Lord be with you.
A prayer for illumination. Gracious Lord, like Nicodemus, we come to the word with many questions. Like the Pharisees, we can be captivated by correctness, intent on right answers. As we turn to your word, Spirit of God, do not let our desire for information dominate our need for transformation. Let us hear the word and be moved to greater faith and obedience. Amen. We shall now read the Old Testament, Deuteronomy, chapter 34, verses 1 through 12. This is when Moses died and is buried in the land of Moab. Then Moses went up from the plains of Moab to Mount Nebo, at the top of Pisgah, which is opposite Jericho, and the Lord showed him the whole land, Gilead as far as Dan, all Naphtali, and the land Ephraim and Manasseh, all the land of Judah as far as the western sea, the Negev and the plain, that is, the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees as far as Zoar. The Lord said to him, this is the land of which I swore to Abraham, to Isaiah, and to Jacob, saying, I will give to all your descendants. I will let you see it with your eyes, but you shall not cross over there. Then Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab, at the Lord's command. He was buried in a valley in the land of Moab, opposite Beth-Peor, but no one knows his burial place to this day. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His sight was unimpaired, and his vigor had not abated. The Israelites wept for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days. Then the period of mourning for Moses was ended. Joshua, son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom because Moses had laid his hands on him, and the Israelites obeyed him, doing as the Lord had commanded Moses. Never since there has been arisen a prophet in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. He was unequaled for all the signs and wonders that the Lord sent him to perform in the land of Egypt against Pharaoh and all his servants and his entire land, and for all the mighty deeds and all the terrifying displays of power that Moses performed in the sight of all Israel. Here ends the reading of the word. Thanks be to God.
From the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 22, verses 34 through 46. Listen for the word of God. When the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked Jesus a question to test him. "Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbors as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the laws and the prophets." Now, while the Pharisees were gathering together, Jesus asked them this question: "What do you think of the Messiah? Whose son is he?" They said to him, "The son of David." Jesus said to them, How is it then that David, by the Spirit, calls him Lord, saying, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet. If David thus calls him Lord, how can he be his son? No one was able to give him an answer, nor from the day did anyone dare to ask him any more questions. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. We are living in a shifting reality these days. Worship without gathering, celebrating the God we find in the faces of each other without being side by side with each other, praising together without feeling the real-time vibrations of music and singing surrounding us, sharing communion without receiving the blessings of God's saving grace, without the taste and touch of the bread and wine at the same time, in the same place. We are living in a shifting reality these days. For those fortunate enough to have jobs you can do at home, there's no true office place camaraderie. Those able to go into the workplace do so masked and distanced, with varying degrees of levels of risk to you and those in your household. For many, far too many, there is no work to be done, no income. For them, hunger is an actuality, and the threat of homelessness weighs mightily on their minds and hearts. It is a harsh reality. An uncontrolled pandemic continues to shape our lives and take our loved ones away. Brutally contested elections that will shape our living for decades to come. Disagreements that have morphed into an unprecedented level of physical violence and killings the likes of which we have not known in recent years, in our constitutionally protected protests, in our homes, and assassination attempts to our public leaders, mayors, governors, legislators, journalists. Angry shouting and belligerence overtake reasonable and healthy dialogue. We live in a shifting reality these days. So many voices, so many things. Where is the voice and the sound of the good gospel good news? How do we find and hear the voice of God? Last night, I participated in a bi-monthly meeting of the worship committee for my church. It seems like it was just a few short weeks ago we were figuring out how to celebrate Lent and Easter in a vibrant and virtual computerized format. Last night, we found ourselves in a similar dilemma, trying to figure out how to create meaningful worship during Advent and Christmas. The last time we worshiped together in our sanctuary, as I'm sure it has been true here, the last time we were together was March 15th, over 7 months ago. Back then, our biggest concern was creating a format for worship services that could be sent to our worshipers via the computer. Half the congregation had literally no experience with social media. Zoom church was a foreign concept. Did I really want to get enmeshed in the world of Facebook? For the younger generation, it was a no-brainer. Fortunately, we have those in our congregations whose social and professional existence revolve around social media. Those faithful souls make themselves available to patiently and repeatedly teach the rest of us. It is a steep learning curve. Now we approach Advent and Christmas, and we are confronted with new challenges. How do we make Christmas real and meaningful in a virtual world that is less real and often seems meaningless? And it is an ever elusive goal. How do we hold firm to a good news gospel in a pandemic, violent, and isolating world? In Mark's gospel, chapter 1, verse 15, Jesus tells his disciple, the kingdom of God is at hand. Believe the good news. God's kingdom is here, touchable and real, even in our isolation. The Lord's Prayer says, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. The good news is that the important step in God's saving grace has been fulfilled. The kingdom comes to earth as it is in heaven. Jesus was God's word made flesh to live among us and show us how to live into the hope of God's kingdom. The good news is not just some otherworldly existence that we must patiently wait for. The good news is here, now, today, even in the midst of our broken and hurtful world. Fear and doubt are especially abundant these days. Our faith is certainly being challenged in new and even more frightening ways, but we can remember what we are told in the book of Hebrews. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for and convictions of things not seen. That is the faith of Moses from our Deuteronomy reading. The passage describes the closing days of Moses' ministry. Here we learn that Moses will not be permitted to see the promised land. It seems unfair. Moses gave all he had to lead God's people there. Life threats repeatedly and repeated confrontation with the Pharaoh, a man with unlimited mortal power, doing all within that power to stop Moses. His undaunting leadership of the masses, an unshakable commitment of a higher power. 40 years in the arid desert with thousands depending on his message of God's promise, a stellar faith and a full throttle commitment, and a final analysis, it does not seem to be enough for Moses to have a fulfillment of God's promise on earth, that is to see the promised land. It seems unfair. But Moses seems to understand something that is difficult for most humans. It is not through good works that Moses is gifted with walking into the promised land. Good works was not the standard. Nevertheless, I get the distinct impression that Moses is content with this final human to God interaction. Moses' faith is enough. Paul calls it justification through faith. I'd like to share a story with you. When I was in seminary, I had a classmate. We were working on a project together. And we were working out the formatting for a document. And abruptly she says, seemingly unrelated comment, she says, I get it. I said, what? You get what? I get the justification through faith, by grace. I get it. And I said, justification? What does justification have to do with the project at hand? It's getting late, Karen. And she says to me, it's like the computer justifying your margins. It's like the computer knows how to line up your left and right margins. The left margins are already aligned, but the right margins, you have to put in a request so that the lines are evenly spread out. Then I had a visual image. I had an image of God's grace filling in the spaces, making our margins even. The amount of space on the right depends on how many letters and spaces are in that line. And when you give the computer the command, I mean precisely the command, at the same point each time, an unjustified margin would otherwise appear. But with the command, with the request, God's grace fills out those spaces and takes us to our boundaries. I could see justification. I had no idea what to do to make myself create such an alignment But then I decided, I don't really need to know. I just need to know how to type in the words and make the adjustment. And when I reach the end of the line, grace fills in the spaces. I could visualize my salvation. All I needed to do was to put in the request, to ask God to fulfill the good news, to show me the good news, to fulfill the promise. I can't align the ends of my life and become worthy of God's love and saving grace. I can't on my own. I can't justify my paragraphs, but I don't need to. I don't need to because God's grace has already aligned my margins. We are justified. We have the promise. We have the good news of the gospel. Someone once said, faith is not blind. And the gospel message is not about blind, passive, thoughtless obedience to a distant God. It's not about Moses feeling cheated because he did not get to walk into the promised land. It's about a trust in a personal God, but that trust does not exist in a vacuum, devoid of human realities. Human doubt is what makes trust worth pursuing. Trust happens despite the elements of doubt and fear. And indeed, trust happens. Faith happens because of those fears. Doubt and fear does not have to be an obstacle to a trusting faith. On the contrary, it is, as Kathleen Norris has said, merely the seeds of a sign that faith is alive and ready to grow. Doubt and fear is an important ongoing element of faithfulness. If we suppress our doubts, it is not possible to fully commune with God and deepen that relationship. To trust God does not mean no questions, no doubts, no arguments allowed. Faith devoid of intellectual inquiry is a stagnant faith. In the same way, faith devoid of trust is a useless faith. A balance leads to trust and trust to action. We are justified by faith through grace, through the promise of the gospel. The gospel says nothing about good times. The times are horrible, but the news is good. The gospel is always good. We cannot earn it. We simply accept it and respond with trust and obedience. Yet we must recognize the ambiguity of our relationship with our Creator. Rather than ignoring inconsistencies, we must challenge them. Sometimes we need to just shake our collective and individual fists at God and demand some answers. Why are we killing ourselves? Why are we having such a hard time doing what needs to be done to take care of ourselves in the face of this worldwide panic, pandemic? Why are we fighting with each other with such vitriol and anger and violence? Why are we in such despair, O God? We have doubt, we have fear. And when we honestly tell God how we feel, only then can we cope with the contradictions. We don't have to explain everything. We just have to find ways to let the tensions lead us to deeper relationships with the source of our being, with the source of the good news. As a relationship deepens, trust also deepens. Our believing is not a blind faith, but a seeing faith, a faith justified by faith and grounded in the good news of the gospel. When we hear our name, we can respond clearly with the affirmation, "Here I am, Lord, send me." Amen. I believe in God, the Creator Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, killed, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God, the Creator Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Will you pray with me? Oh, gracious God, sometimes the blows of life hit us. Are others that we love and care for and leave us numb and speechless. There seems to be no reason, no fair accounting as to how and why sickness and tragedy and pandemics and vitriol violence strike. At times we do not know just how or what to pray for, and so we moan and weep and we are silent in your presence. We listen to each other with our hearts and hold each other's virtual hands and say prayers that are often feel earthbound. Yet, O Lord, in the presence of the wounds and the hurts we fail to understand, there comes to us like gifts the courage to face pain, the tenacity to stand our ground, the strength to fight the evil that has stricken us, the self-worth to infuse pity at our own stance. For some, healing comes, and if not, surprisingly, a sense of victory or even blessing, knowing that we have done our best and your presence is with us. And so, O Lord, we pray for those whose pain and troubles seem more than they can bear. May we all claim the victories of healing and hope that each of us hold through the promise. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, amen.
Now it is the time for our offering. Thank you for all your gifts, time, and talents which you have given to the church. Please continue to send in your checks to the church or use the online giving option. For the blessings of this and all our days, we thank you, gracious God. Accept, we pray, not just this offering, but also our lives freely offered in gratitude for all you have done for us. Use them both in this place and wherever you might take us. Amen. Thank you.
And now, my sisters and brothers, confirm your faith in a life that is filled with despair. And be aware of our responsibilities as the Church of Christ in a world that is filled with love. Go forth to the work and joy of this day and all your days in the name of God Almighty, believing that the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ goes with you. Amen.